When it comes to live-action adaptations of anime and manga titles, we Americans have about as much finesse as Ron Jeremy trying to give a lecture to children about abstinence. It just seems that if a movie based on a manga or an anime comes out of an American production company from an American director, it's just inevitable. It's going to suck. And just when I thought that I had seen the worst of them, I stumble across one that just puts more icing on the shit cake. And that movie is Fist of the North Star. For those of you who don't know, Fist of the North Star started out as a post-apocalyptic martial arts manga by Bronson and Tetsuo Hara in 1983. Because of its popularity, it was eventually adapted into an anime series, which some American fans were probably introduced to back when Encore Action was actually useful and had an anime block. The show is still fairly popular in the States and has multiple spin-offs, sequels, and even a few video games, which thankfully buried this 1995 direct-to-video movie until I would say fairly recently. The movie, much like the anime and manga series, takes place in the future wasteland of the year 1990X, where violence is rampant, and apparently they're too lazy to add the last digit. The story revolves around Kenshiro, a wandering master of a martial art known as Hakuto Shinken, as he happens upon a village that is being targeted by a group of thugs because it is a precious water source. While in the village, he uses his magical Jesus powers to heal an orphan named Lin, and I guess subsequently semi-befriends both her and her brother Bat.
Rufio!
Oh, Dante Bosco, what happened to your movie career? Anyway, Kenshiro doesn't want to help the orphans or defend the village because he is on the search for Shin, his longtime rival and the man that kidnapped his girlfriend, nearly killing him in the process. He leaves the village, but after hearing the screams of Lin, which I guess happens when you heal someone with your mighty Jesus powers, he makes the decision that he will fully realize his role as Fist of the North Star and rescue her. Shortly thereafter, it is revealed to Kenshiro that Shin is the leader of the thugs, and he must go to kill him to restore the balance of the universe that Shin set in motion after killing Ken's father and nearly killing him. Now, from what I remember, which granted isn't all that much, considering the last time I saw anything from this series was about 10 years ago, the movie actually does follow the first arc of the anime and manga fairly well, or at least well enough for me to recognize some of what's going on. And that's about the only nice thing I'll be able to say about this movie. I mean, don't get me wrong, there are things that it does screw up as far as the first arc, but at least I can see something resembling a Fist of the North Star story. But let's face it. I mean, how many of us actually watched Fist of the North Star for its amazing storylines? So I guess, congrats, movie, you semi got something right that probably none of us who are fans of the series really gave a shit about. Unfortunately, the real problems of this movie rear their ugly head from the get-go, with an opening credit scene that feels way too long and doesn't even tie anything in. It's just credits. You don't get any lead into the movie, no exposition dump, no awesome fight scene or something to catch your eye, just credits. For 3 minutes. It's almost like the director was trying to tell me something. Like, maybe I should just go grab a beer and shut this movie off and pretend like it was mercifully quick and painless. If I wasn't such a glutton for punishment, I would have done so. Because the problems only snowball from here. For those of you who have ever seen the anime or read the manga, You probably know that the main focus isn't exactly extremely well-developed characters. But somehow, some way, in some kind of freakish turn in the cosmos, they managed to give the characters even less personality. Seriously, Gary Daniels plays Kenshiro with this ridiculous, wide-eyed, soul-sucking stare in almost every scene he's in. The set must have been stocked with Visine, because I don't think I ever saw the man blink more than once in the entire movie. He's also supposed to have this semi-affectionate friendship with Lin and Bat. However, most of the time it just comes off either feeling hollow or just plain creepy.
I'm ready.
Breathing.
What? Hey! What are you doing here?
Breathing.
Huh. I guess that's the way you're supposed to talk to children if you're John Wayne Gacy. Hey, movie! Do you think you can turn down the pedo dial just a bit? That'd be great. This has to be the weirdest portrayal of Kenshiro they could have ever thought up. Because even him being introduced into the movie involves one of the oddest scenes I think has ever been committed to film.
I need shelter.
This is Radio Southern Cross. The liberation of the wasteland has begun. The recreation of human civilization.
The broadcast is from the south.
Are you serious? This guy walks up to your house, practically demands a place to stay. And the first thing you can think to say to him is,
"The broadcast is from the south."
"Oh, really? You don't say. I would have never guessed that a broadcast from the city of Southern Cross would be from the south. I mean, I thought it was WKRP in Cincinnati. Actually, given how the city of Southern Cross looks, it might not be that far from the truth. But if you can believe it, this scene gets made worse by Kenshiro's dead-eyed answer.
I know.
Hey Bob from the Tim Burton Batman movie, what exactly was your plan? To annoy him with obvious statements until he goes away? Either that, or this may have been a cheap way to educate Gary Daniels while on set.
The broadcast is from the south. I know.
Oh, wait. It gets better. Just watch what happens when Kenshiro gets into his first fight about one scene later.
Take your hands off me!
You people blown out here? What do you want?
We don't want. We take.
Just let her go. We'll give you anything that we have.
Give? You don't give! We teach! What are you gonna do now, huh? Oh, we're gonna hit
Words do not describe this level of what the fuckery. I mean, I know that the moves look ridiculous even in the manga and anime, but come on, Gary Daniels is a former kickboxing champion. You don't think he could have stopped somebody and said, "You know what, guys? This looks fucking stupid. I think I'm gonna try something else that looks much cooler." As you can tell from that scene, the dialogue is not just bad, it's some of the worst cockamamie bullfuck to ever spew from an actor's mouth. The characters especially villains, just talk like they've been reading too many old copies of the Ultimate Warriors comic book.
When the warrior's blood boils, and you have the boss of fear that the warrior's soul see through the outer structure, I will rip out a black heart and see through it as it was written long ago, for you will be a sacrifice to Destrucity.
But all of that aside, the biggest problem that this movie has is the fight scenes. The main thing anyone is going to be watching this movie for is the fight scenes. So why would you fuck them up? Why? I mean, you would think that they could take martial arts from a popular martial arts manga and anime series and make them look cool on screen. But nope. Not a single one of the fight scenes are impressive or memorable, with the exception of the final fight between Kenshiro and Shin. But that's because I was too distracted by Shin's backwards leather dress ensemble to actually pay attention to what they were doing. And the whole time they were talking and fighting, this was the dialogue I actually heard in my head. "Hey there, Kenshiro. I wore this dress just for you. Don't I look fabulous?"
"It doesn't matter. You're already dead. If by dead you mean drop dead gorgeous."
When it comes right down to it, I'd rather have a colonoscopy with a splintery wooden spoon than ever watch this movie again. The first 30 to 40 minutes of the movie felt like it could have been so bad it's good material. But the charm quickly wanes as it starts to drag out, and you realize just how little this movie has to offer. The fighting scenes are sparse, and only a handful of them are funny or interesting. The dialogue is like my earholes being fucked with the sharpened tip of a pencil, and what little character the original ever had was completely scrapped in this movie. I think what's most disappointing for me is that I feel as though this could have been saved and turned into a cult classic had they actually injected a lot more of the head-exploding hyper-violence as they have in the show. At least then it would have something to offer to the audience. Now, it is available to stream on Netflix, and you can still buy it on DVD, but my recommendation is to stay away from this Hokuto no shit stain. That's my review of Fist of the North Star. Neighborhood Friendly Ranter, signing out.
The world needs a leader.
Did it choose you?
I chose it. He chose nothing.
I choose you, Bulbasaur!